Sound design.
So how do you maximize gain before feedback of a podium microphone using Smaart? So why would you want to do this? Well, podium microphones can be tricky, right? If someone stands at the proper distance and you have the sound system, you know, in front of the podium microphone, if all of the factors are lined up in your favor, it's usually not a problem. But what happens more often than not with the podium microphone is that you have people of all different shapes and sizes who use the microphone in all different ways. So you'll have someone who walks up to the microphone and they're like at the perfect distance and they speak loudly and they project, no problem. And then you have another person comes up who's way too tall or way too short and they stand way back from it, or worst case scenario, they grab the microphone and like shove it over here or over there, and now it's in completely the wrong place and you can't get enough gain before feedback. So you're like bringing up the microphone, it's starting to feedback, and then you have to try and figure out which frequency is feeding back. So what I used to do in the past when that happened is I would start out in my mix console, and what I would do is I would run all of my vocal microphones, including my podium microphones, through some kind of a vocal bus, and then I would put a graphic EQ on that bus, and then I would turn the microphone on and just bring it up in the house, and first frequency that would feedback, I would turn that down and find the next one and the next one and the next one. And then, you know, by the end of it, I would end up with, you know, a real cut up graphic EQ that looks something like this, totally changing the response of the system at that point. Okay, so let me show you what I've started doing instead. So last year, Chris Leonard came over. I did an interview with him for the podcast. And one of the things he shared with me is that when he worked on the presidential inaugurations, the sound engineer who did that event used this process where he would take a transfer function measurement of the sound system from behind the sound system with the podium mic as the measurement microphone instead of a regular measurement microphone out in front of the sound system. Let me show you what I mean. I'll show you how I have this routed. Okay, so over here in Smaart now, these are the transfer functions I'm normally running with on a show, and I've got this one called Mon, which is short for monitor. And very simply, it uses the same reference input as all my other measurements here. So A, B, C are all just different microphone inputs with the same reference input. Now over on Mon, I've just routed the monitor output of my console into another input on my audio interface. That way, I can solo up any channel on the board. In this case, I would solo up the podium microphone or the vocal bus that it's running through. And now I've put that entire signal chain into the measurement. So it's going to measure all of the processing I have on my podium mic input channel, and it's going to measure the processing that I have on this vocal group. And that's what I wanted to do. So let me show you a couple more setup things. So I showed you the input here. It's just another input on my audio interface. I can't show that to you because it's not connected right now. And then over here in the X32, the routing is like this. So on the aux output one, I'm just taking a pre-fader, pre-low cut, pre-processing output from matrix one that I'm using for the main system out. And then that's pretty much it, because the monitor output is already automatically going to send out whatever I have soloed. So these are my monitor settings here. So I hit solo on the vocal bus here. That's going to send that out of the monitor output. That's going to come into my monitor input here, and I already showed you how the reference was routed. So here's the measurement that I get then. By the way, I should mention that I always mute this, so I don't actually put the podium microphone into the sound system while I'm doing the measurement. Some people do that though, and I haven't tried that much. It's probably the next thing I should try. I posted about this on Facebook last year, and a few people told me that when they do the exact same thing for their monitor wedges with their vocal microphones, and what they will do is actually put the vocal mic into the monitor wedge, into the sound system, and bring it up until it's about to feed back, and then do that measurement. I'm not doing that. I'm muting the podium microphone in the sound system, but I'm soloing it so that it goes to the monitor bus so that I can use that for my measurement input. Okay, so here's the measurement that I get. You can see that coherence is really bad, and that's because I'm only measuring sound coming, if there's any direct sound, it's coming from the back of the sound system, which is probably why it looks like I locked onto the measurement here, you know, using the low frequency drivers of the back of the speaker, which is why we have, if we have relatively good coherence here and flat phase here, that's where it's locked on. I didn't see this until now, but you can see that the peak in the live IR is actually way up here. And I think I probably didn't see it because I was probably zoomed in like this and I didn't see anything. But if you zoom out, you can see that there's a peak up here, which is at about 27 milliseconds. So although this measurement was made at 87 milliseconds, I probably could have turned it down to 60 milliseconds to actually get this peak here, right here at zero, and maybe get better coherence overall. Anyway, I'll have to pay attention to that next time. So this is the measurement that I get. It almost always looks something like this with a lot of like 200 hertz coming in, and more would be coming in. It would probably just keep going, the trend would just keep going up and up and up if I didn't have a low cut here at 178 on the podium microphone, and that's why it stops going up after it gets here to about 150. Okay, so this is the first measurement. I'm gonna take the coherence away so we can just look at that. The first thing I looked at was I said, hey, there's this peak here at 200. Let me get rid of that. So this peak here at 200 is around the 6 dB mark. This second peak here is around the 0 dB mark. So I'll cut 6 dB around 200. That's what you see here. 200 hertz minus 6 dB. Here's that. And then I said, hey, let me just put in a low shelf to try and make all this stuff down here at around the same height here, the same level. So this is at around minus 12. So I'll need to put in minus 12. So I actually started this like that, which seems crazy, right? Like that's a lot to cut. But that got it down to a flatter response. So I took a measurement afterwards, which looks like this. So now you can see much flatter response here. And that has been my goal so far. Let me just return the response to flat and see if that does it for me. This is probably not the best way to do it. Flat is probably not the best target in this case because once soundcheck starts, I always have to make adjustments. So once soundcheck started, I basically just listened and dialed this low shelf back until it sounded natural. So someone's speaking on the podium microphone and I'm just reducing this low shelf until it sounds natural and it's not feeding back and things are working well. That makes me think that probably in the future I should try shooting for not a flat target, but maybe something more like the same target that I use for measuring in front of the system instead of behind it. Because if I hide this guy and bring this guy up, it doesn't quite match. So I don't know, I'll have to play with this some more, but I'm thinking I need to develop a different target that's for stuff behind the system, for things that are just like doing a lobe study, just measuring bleed, overlap, that kind of stuff. Because I didn't get rid of this. You would think if this were a problem, I would have cut it out of the input channel around 900 hertz. But we can take a look at the input channel if the X32 doesn't crash. And we can see that I'm not cutting around 900 hertz, cutting several other places. I have been testing this out over the last few months, trying to kind of work it into my system tuning process. It takes a little bit more time, and I know we're all busy, and there's never enough time. So I had to practice and really force myself to try it until it became something that I could sort of do quickly and get together. What I needed was one more input on my audio interface, basically. So I needed one more cable, so now there's one more thing I have to do during the setup process, but now that I've practiced it a few times, it's become quick enough. I have the cable right there in my measurement rig, so I just pull it out, connect the monitor output from the console to the third input on my audio interface, and I'm ready to go. All right, I would love to know if you guys have tried this or if you're doing this already. Let me know some other places that you've tested it, maybe on a podium microphone, maybe on a vocal monitor wedge, that kind of stuff. Basically anywhere where we're measuring overlap from the sound system, reflections, buildup, bleed, that kind of stuff. So let me know what your experience has been.
Sound design. Live.